In this lecture video, we'll talk about acid-base titrations. But first, I'd like to just introduce the titration experiment. Titration is an analytical technique to determine the concentration of a sample, which we would call the analyte, by using a chemical reaction with a reagent called the titrant. Here, our analyte is in this Erlenmeyer flask where we know the volume, but not the concentration. And our titrant would be in this burette where we do know the concentration and the volume. In the titration experiment, the titrant is slowly added to the analyte until all the analyte is reacted away. So we would position the burette above the analyte solution, as shown here, and we would slowly add the titrant dropwise to the solution of the analyte in the flask. At the point where the analyte is all used up, which we call the equivalence point, we can determine the concentration of the analyte by figuring out how much titrant or how many moles of titrant was used. At the equivalence point, we would have added a specific amount of titrant such that all the analyte A has reacted away to form products. And by knowing the initial versus the final volume, we can first figure out how much titrant or how many moles was used, and then back out how many moles of the analyte were originally in the flask. And from knowing the original volume, we can then determine the concentration. An acid-base titration uses a neutralization reaction between an acid and base. And the equivalence point is usually determined with a pH indicator that changes color visually upon reaching a specified pH value. The titrant can either be a strong acid like hydronium ion or a strong base like hydroxide. So our reaction in this experiment is a neutralization reaction between our analyte and titrant. And in neutralization reaction, one of those products should be water. So we can have different types of analyte, acidic or basic, and within these groups, we can have strong, weak, or polyprotic. If the analyte is acidic, then the titrant would be hydroxide to form water and conjugate bases. If the analyte is basic, then we would choose to use the hydronium ion as the titrant to form water in this neutralization reaction and other ion products. In this course, we're not really looking to solve for some unknown concentration of an analyte. Rather, we use acid-base titrations as a teaching framework to basically bring together many of the acid-base equilibria concepts that we've learned so far. In the rest of this video, we'll talk about the titration experiments of a strong acid and a weak acid. And in the next video lecture, we'll move on to polyprotic acids as well as strong bases and weak bases. In this first titration experiment, we have HCl, a strong acid, as our analyte, and we're going to use as a titrant the strong base sodium hydroxide. And both of these concentrations are set to be equal at 0.1 molar. Oftentimes, we like to monitor the pH changes during a titration experiment, and this is often plotted in something called a titration curve, where along the y-axis, we have the pH of the solution in the flask below, and on the x-axis, we have the volume of added base, which would be the titrant here. So initially, at the very start of this experiment, we haven't added any base yet, and so we're starting with just 0.1 molar HCl. And we know that a solution of a strong acid dissociates fully to form hydronium ions. And so that means at the starting point, we have 0.1 molar of hydronium ions. And by taking the minus log of this value, we get that the solution begins at pH 1. The other point is at the very end when the pH would have plateaued. And this would happen when a lot of the base has been added, such that the concentration of added base will be much larger than the initial concentration of the acid. So hydroxide here would be in vast excess. Then in this reaction, after hydronium ion gets neutralized by all this hydroxide, we'll have basically no hydronium ions left. It would be approximately 0 molar. And the hydroxide concentration, on the other hand, would begin to approach the concentration originally used in the titrant. Now, it would only approach that concentration because as we're adding it, the volume is getting larger, and so it would have been somewhat diluted. But in the end, because we have only hydroxide left, our pH would be highly basic, and this would be near 13. Between these two extremes, somewhere in the middle, is a point where the moles of base added would just equal the moles of acid initially present. This defined is the equivalence point. So we would have the concentration of acid equal to the concentration of hydroxide that's been added. And because these are equal, they would annihilate each other to form water. So after neutralization, essentially the concentration of the acid and hydroxide is basically zero, and we only have water, such that the pH at the equivalence point should be 7. Now, we do know that at pH 7, we technically have hydronium ions and hydroxide ions. They are 1 times 10 to the minus 7 molar. But you can see this is indeed a really small number. And so we can say approximately those concentrations are 0. So just to recap, at the equivalence point, the hydronium ions and the hydroxide are just neutralized and water's the product. Now, there are other products present in solution, namely the sodium ions that came with sodium hydroxide and the chloride ions that originally came from HCl. But remember, these are spectator ions that would not change the pH of a water solution. So with these species present in water, the pH would be 7. With those 3 points in place, we can now fill in the rest of the pH data points. And they're really divided along this equivalence point. Before the equivalence point, the volume of base added is such that the concentration of hydroxide is less than the initial concentration of HCl. And so all the pH prior to the equivalence point would be acidic. After the equivalence point, then the concentration of hydroxide will be greater than the hydronium ion that was initially present. And so with the excess hydroxide, all these pH values would be basic until it basically plateaus to about pH 13. In this whole curve, we are basically performing the neutralization reaction, but depending on the ratio of hydronium ions to hydroxide, we could still be in the acidic regime or the basic regime, or when they're perfectly equal at the equivalence point at pH 7. So one question you might have is, why does the plot curve? And that's because even though the concentration of hydronium ion is changing approximately linearly as you add base, this is a pH plot. And remember, pH is not proportional to hydronium concentration, but rather it's equal to the minus log of the concentration. And so these curvatures are reflective of the minus log function. Another important feature of the titration curve is that the steepest pH changes occur near the equivalence point. And so you can see the slope of this curve is very gradual, and then it shoots up very steeply right around the equivalence point before it again becomes more gradual. And this is typical for all acid-based titrations. Next, we're going to move into the titration of a weak acid. And to help set this up, I'm going to compare what we just did for a strong acid and show you what we would get for a weak acid, like acetic acid here on the right. So here are their titration curves side by side. And as a quick reminder, in the HCl case, we start at pH of 1. We go through an equivalence point of pH 7, and we end with a pH that's close to 13. If we compare to the weak acid side, you'll notice that the pH value at the very end is about 13, just like in the strong acid case. And this should make sense because this is when the titrant sodium hydroxide is in vast excess. And in these two titration experiments, they both use sodium hydroxide. But if we look at where the equivalence point and the starting pH value is, you'll notice that both of these pH points are actually shifted up. The equivalence point here is not pH 7, but is actually basic, and the starting pH value isn't as acidic as for a strong acid. You might also notice this funny curvature along the titration curve as highlighted here. This slide is a preview of the three questions we want to pose about the titration of a weak acid with sodium hydroxide. First, why is the starting pH slightly higher? That would be this point here. Why is the pH greater than 7 or basic at the equivalence point, represented by the second point here? And then in between these points, why is the curve fairly flat before it rises steeply around the equivalence point? To get started, why is the starting pH slightly higher or less acidic relative to the strong acid? And the answer is simply that this is a weak acid, and weak acids do not dissociate to completion. Acetic acid has a very low Ka value, and that means this dissociation reaction actually favors the reactants, where the weak acid is mostly intact, and only a minor percentage will dissociate to form the hydronium ions. And because the pH is the minus log of the hydronium ion concentration, it will be less acidic than a strong acid case, given the same concentration. The next question is, why is the pH basic at the equivalence point? The reaction that's occurring during the titration is neutralization. So here we have our weak acid plus hydroxide, and they neutralize to form water and the conjugate base acetate. The equivalence point, by definition, is when the moles of added hydroxide equal the moles of the initial amount of weak acid. And so in this reaction of neutralization, if these two are equimolar, and they react fully to the right, then essentially we have zero concentration of these two species, and instead we have predominant formation of the two products, including acetate, the conjugate base. Once we have the conjugate base form, this may remind you of a reaction we studied earlier where weak base dissociates in water in a Kb reaction to form hydroxide and a little bit of the weak acid. And it's this formation of the hydroxide in the Kb reaction that makes the solution pH basic at the equivalence point. The third question is, why in this region is the curve fairly flat as we move towards the equivalence point? And again, in a titration experiment, we want to think about this neutralization reaction. Now, in the midpoint of this region, the volume of added base is actually half the volume of base needed to reach the equivalence point. What that means then is that the moles of hydroxide will be half the initial moles of the weak acid. In this neutralization reaction, half of the original acetic acid will be neutralized by hydroxide to form water and the conjugate base, but another half will remain behind unreacted. And so that means the concentration of the acid and its conjugate base will be equal. And hopefully this will remind you of a buffer solution where the pH can be calculated using the Henderson-Hasselbalch equation shown here. Now at this exact midpoint, these concentrations are equal, so the pH would just be the pKa of acetic acid, and that's 4.74. In the buffer region, the capacity can range from 10 to 1 base to acid or 1 to 10 base to acid. And so that would be represented by these extremes here in the blue dotted lines. And at those extremes, the pH would range from pKa minus 1 all the way to pKa plus 1. And so from this point to this point would be the whole buffer region, where exactly in the middle we would have the pH being equal to the pKa. As a recap, I'd like to go over the important points in the titration curve of acetic acid, an example of a weak acid, with sodium hydroxide, a strong base. So we're going to start here where we initially have no base, and we're going to move along as bases added, so increasing sodium hydroxide. Initially, we just have acetic acid, and we have a weak acid dissociation reaction, which accounts for the fact that the starting pH value is only slightly acidic. Moving towards the buffer region, we reach the midpoint of the buffer zone, where the concentration of the acid is now equal to the concentration of its conjugate base. And exactly at this point, the pH will be the pKa of acetic acid. Moving towards the equivalence point, this is where we basically annihilate all of the weak acid, and the dominant species now is the conjugate base. And because this conjugate base can perform a Kb reaction to form hydroxide, the pH will be basic. And lastly, as we continuously add more hydroxide, we still have acetate present, but now this excess hydroxide is really responsible for the pH changes. We approach a pH value of 13 for 0.1 molar sodium hydroxide, and this is consistent with a strong base dissociation problem where you would calculate the pH given a concentration of sodium hydroxide. In the last slide, I'd just like to overlay the titration of a strong acid in orange versus that of a weak acid in purple. And you can see that in the basic regime, they almost overlay with each other perfectly, but they have different equivalence points, different starting points, and also the presence of a buffer in the weak acid case. Now, these stripes correspond to pH indicators that have different colors for specific ranges of pH values. And so if we were trying to find the endpoint of this titration, we would want the equivalence point to be matched by the correct indicator. So indicators are not required on exams in this course, but we will use them in some of our demos, and just wanted to show that this is how you would choose the correct pH indicator depending on where your equivalence point pH would be.